environmental flows process in Texas. I'll give you a brief introduction to the process, talk about the environmental side, and Glenn is going to give you sort of a water supply perspective. Kind of want to share with you some perspectives and recount a story to do that. Jack Davis and I, many years ago, were sampling Bull Creek in North Austin, and it's a picturesque limestone bottom, a shallow, clear stream. And Jack was collecting benthic macroinvertebrates, and I was collecting periphyton growing on the rocks. And being a very shallow stream, he and I were both walking around the stream like this for about 20 or 30 minutes. And as I got close to the shore to collect some samples, a cat jumped on my back. Not in a malicious way, but just like your cat would jump on your lap to be petted. And I stood there and thinking this was a little unusual, and I started walking around, and the cat stayed on my back. And Jack and I realized that although we had started out to collect water samples, something about our job had changed that at that point in time. And so this environmental flows process, we've gotten into it, and we go into it with one frame of mind, and circumstances change, and we find that our responsibilities have shifted a little bit. We decided we needed to find the owner for that cat. We took it home. On the way home, I told Jack, I said, stop, buy a newspaper. Let's look in the classifieds for a lost pet ad. And sure enough, there the ad was, $200 reward for lost gray cat, and our cat was a gray cat. I said, man, we've hit the jackpot. But of course, as I'm sure you could imagine, we got back and called, and it wasn't their cat. And that's kind of the second lesson related to environmental flows is you start and you think you're shooting towards a particular goal and objective, and sometimes that objective or what you think is the end shifts on you. About a week after that, my boss came up to me in the hall and he said, I heard you guys killed a cat when you were out sampling about a week ago. And that's kind of the third perspective I've learned is that in this environmental flows process, you hear a lot of people have a very different take on what the outcome of the process was. But we did find the home for the cat, and that worked. Who is this agency, and why are all those arrows pointed at them? The Texas Commission on Environmental Quality is the state agency that's responsible for setting water rights permits. Senate Bill 3, which Glenn and I are going to be talking about, was passed in 2007, and the goal is to identify the amounts of water that needs to be in rivers and get to bays to keep them healthy, ecologically healthy. And their approach is to develop environmental flow standards and permits to implement those environmental flow standards, and the TCEQ is the agency that's going to do that work. The legislation established an environmental flows advisory group, 6 legislators, and 3 members, board members or commission members of the agencies that deal with water in Texas. And in turn, the Environmental Flows Advisory Group established a Bay Basin stakeholder group consisting of about 20 to 30 folks from each of the major basins in Texas. But actually, this is a staggered process. So they started with the first 2 major river basins in the east side of Texas. They're going in sort of a staggered fashion from east to west across the state. They also set up a science advisory committee. That science advisory committee's responsibility was to describe the technical process that was going to be followed in creating the science for environmental flow analysis in Texas. They also, the Bay Basin stakeholders then assigned what were called Bay Basin expert science teams. And I was on the Bay Basin expert science team for the Trinity River. And so that's where my involvement in the process began. There were about 10 to 15 people on the team, academicians, consultants, scientists from water providers. And what you see is that the Bay Basin expert team, here's their charge in 1 year, using best available science, the implication being they're not collecting additional samples or data. They're supposed to decide in a consensus-based fashion what amount of water needs to be in the rivers and get into the bays to keep those systems environmentally sound. And they do that by developing a report with environmental flow regimes that go to the Texas Commission on Environmental Quality. They go back to the stakeholders, and they also go to the Science Advisory Committee. I don't think I have an arrow showing that. The interesting thing is that once the expert science team provides its recommendations, nobody can change them. The TCEQ and the stakeholders and the science committee can say the science was bad. The stakeholders can say, we think there are aspects they did not consider. And the TCEQ may not be happy with them, but they can't change them. And one of the aspects of the task for the expert science team that I did not mention is that they're supposed to carry out their task only thinking about the environmental effects of this water without any consideration of how this flow regime they're developing will be implemented, how it will be translated into environmental flow standards, and how permits may be issued associated with it. So they're supposed to be solely focused on the environmental effects of the flow regime. And of course there are, as if the TCEQ is not hearing from enough folks, they're also hearing from a lot of other people, as I'm sure you can imagine, are interested in the outcomes. So the TCEQ is going to, they're charged with actually developing the environmental flow standards and writing permits that consider those environmental flow standards. I'm going to talk a little bit about kind of the environmental aspects of this process. One of the things that we learn, the best available science, is that a natural flow regime is the flow regime that's most likely to protect a sound environment. And consequently, the state has developed a process that identifies flow regime components that mimic the natural flow regime. And as you can imagine, that usually is based on data obtained from USGS record, flow records. This is the Colorado River in central Texas. And this is what we would call a subsistence flow, one of the flow components of the flow regime. And subsistence flow is a flow that you'd only expect to happen maybe 5% of the time, uncommon during very dry weather. And the hope is that there's enough flow to keep water quality within a minimum condition. You know, it's going to be stressful. It's going to be hot in Texas. And oxygen may drop. But it's supposed to be relatively short. But another aspect of flow regimes, because what we're thinking about how ecological health changes with flow, We know that flow is just one component that affects ecological health. But we know that the main things that flow affects are depth and velocity. As flow changes, we know the depth changes and the velocity changes. And so in a system like this, we know that as the flow increases, right now we've got a very small, short, shallow riffle. As the flow increases, eventually we'll have a broad riffle that will be increased in area, have a different substrate that may be better habitat for other fish and other fish to spawn. The second component in the flow regime is what we call the base flow, low flow, normal flow, stable flow. This is when you're driving across the creek or the river every day to work, and you look down there. Most of the time, it generally looks about the same. This is base flow. The state created a program called the Texas In-Stream Flow Program that is science-based, and their recommendation is that this base flow really has three components, a low and a medium and a high. And the way I look at that is that we know that there are some years are just wetter than usual, and this low flow is a little bit higher, the creek's a little bit higher than it normally is. We know that there are some years that are a little bit drier than normal, maybe not a drought, and the creek is a little bit lower than normal. So this range, this base flow range, captures the change in habitat associated with changing depths and velocities.